The recent rise in gold, for the most part, has been on the back of a weak dollar. Now that the dollar is strengthening, should one get cautious on gold?
Well, I think, you know, the dollar has obviously been very weak. And I mean, you say the dollar has been weak. Yeah, the dollar has been weak, but the other currencies are not much better either, because either they're tied to the dollar one way or the other, or they are not tied to the US dollar. They've gone up against the US dollar. But basically, the ECB in Europe is also a money printer. And the euro has many problems, as well as other currencies that were strong against the US dollar. So what can happen is that essentially the dollar is strong, but gold still holds or even goes up, because other currencies hold their buy also gold. Say if you're a European or if you're a Swiss, maybe you decide to shift some money into gold. And especially, we have now in the world 7 trillion in foreign exchange reserves, up from a trillion in 1996. So we've gone up in the foreign exchange reserves, in international reserves, 7 times. The price of gold hasn't gone up 7 times over that period of time. And in Asia, we have essentially central banks that hold, including Japan, 70% of these $7 trillion. And they have, by and large, less than 2% of their reserves in gold. So I think that a lot of central banks will follow the example of the Reserve Bank of India. By the way, the Reserve Bank of India deserves applause. They've done a very good job, by and large. It's a very well-run central bank.
In terms of Indian equities, which are the best places you would like to invest?
Well, I'm not, you know, a specialist on India, and you really have to ask a stock picker in India. But let's say I'm the chairman of the India Capital Fund, and the manager, John Thorne, he's overweight banks. He likes the banking sector. And I can see why, because in the Western world, the banks are over-leveraged, and they have still huge problems coming along as a result of their exposure both to residential and commercial real estate and so forth and so on. But in India, the banks are relatively sound. They didn't play in the CDO market and mortgage-backed securities market and all kinds of speculative activities and so forth. So they're relatively clean. And obviously, as the population grows, and as the we still have in India 700 million people who live in the countryside, most of them probably don't have a bank account. They're going to have bank accounts, and they're going to have insurance policies and so forth and so on. So for the banks that are well run, there's a huge opportunity.
Is the Indian real estate sector still a major play for Mark Farber?
Well, I like real estate in emerging economies, and in particular in Asia, and in particular in India, because I can see in India urbanization will accelerate, and there will be entirely new cities coming up. So I think there's a big opportunity in Indian real estate in the long run. Now, if you, of course, buy a condo at the peak of the market, maybe in 2007, then maybe the price will go down for 2 or 3 years and so forth. But say, as a business, to develop real estate in India, both in terms of integrated commercial residential centers where you have units that are commercially let out, and then you have shopping centers, movies and hotels, and then service apartments and condos and so forth, that has a huge potential.
The reason I ask about real estate is because many of our real estate companies here in India share the same characteristics as those of the US economy, if you will, because they carry major debt and devalued assets on their books and face very sluggish demand.
Yeah, yeah, but that's the problem. They are over-leveraged, but say, you know, they will, someday they will learn their lessons and no longer use the leverage. In Hong Kong, after 1997, property prices dropped 70%. none of the big developers went bankrupt. Why? Because the property developers in Hong Kong are family owned. And the families, they're relatively conservative, they're all filthy rich, they're all billionaires, and they use a leverage of maybe 20%, 80% is equity. In Hong Kong, most properties actually have no mortgages. Same in Singapore, lots of well-to-do families I know, they own entire buildings, no leverage, not a single mortgage.
One trend that we are observing in the mergers and acquisition markets is that the outright M&A volumes are not really picking up in a major way. We do see some alliances coming through, for instance, Volkswagen and Suzuki globally, and also here in India, United Breweries and Heineken. Do you think this is really the way forward for M&A?
Well, I think the both will happen. Because obviously through alliances you can gain market share exposure into new markets and you can cut cost because, say, your partner in India or wherever it is can take over the distribution and even the production of your product and so forth. But I think at the same time we'll also have a lot of still takeovers. You see, a crisis basically... The purpose of a crisis is to clean the system. That's why I'm against any kind of intervention and supporting companies. You should let them go bust. Because by supporting any company, basically you support the weak participants. But in economics, in the capitalistic system, the strong should survive and not the weak. The weak should be eliminated. And so also the weak, if they're eliminated, they learn a lesson, so they have less leverage thereafter. So you shouldn't reward weakness, you should reward strength. But having said that, in a crisis like we had in 2008, the well-managed companies, the well-financed companies, they swim above the other because they still have cash flow, they still have money to carry out R&D, and they have money to carry out expansion. Weak competitors, they don't have that money. So the gap widens between the strong players in the world and the weak players. And there's a huge opportunity with the strong players.
What are the key commodities that you're currently bullish on?
Well, I was very positive about sugar, and I think it may still go up. But I think there are two commodities right now that stand out in terms of being incredibly depressed. One is wheat. In real terms, inflation adjusted, it's at the 200 years low. And I would essentially look at agricultural commodities at the present time, because they've all come down and they haven't rallied much compared to industrial commodities, which had big moves. Copper has doubled, oil has doubled, and so forth. And the other one is natural gas, very cheap. But it's not so easy for the individual investor to play these commodities. But these, if you ask me which ones are very depressed, these are the two that are extremely, that strike out as being very depressed.